This video is about Pope Pius XII and the Holocaust. What are the facts and what is fiction? Was he a hero or a villain? For some he is the hero and the saint, for others he is just a villain and most people don't really know. Who is the real Pius XII? He became very active in Germany as the nuncio by signing a concordat or a contract with Hitler. Why a concordat? Because he was involved with the canon law and he knew it was important to protect the church from influence by the state. So he was negotiating contracts with Bavaria, with Prussia, while he was a nuncio in Germany. And then when Hitler took over in 1933, he also signed a contract with Hitler, because he wanted to protect the Catholics from this new government. So, interestingly enough, the initiative did not come from the Vatican, but from Hitler, who did not want Catholic clergymen in party politics. So Hitler sent his representative, who was not well received by Pacelli, who was the Secretary of State in the meantime, because he didn't place much faith in Hitler's promises. But when the Catholic Center Party was almost dissolved in Germany, something had to be done to protect the Catholics, and Pope Pius XII thought he would do that. It was maybe a diplomatic remedy and not a moral outrage, but still it had to be done. So no wonder that during and after World War II, when he had become Pope Pius XII, he was still a hero. So in 1942, the New York Times called his Christmas address a lonely voice. And Weizmann, the first president of the future Israel, would say this was a powerful help for us. Winston Churchill called him the greatest man of our time. And Kempner, a prosecutor at the Nuremberg trial, praised him for all he did against war crimes. Even shortly after his death in 1958, he was still praised. It took the New York Times 3 days to print all the tributes of New York City rabbis alone. And Golda Meir, the foreign minister at that time in Israel, praised him for all he had done. And the chief rabbi during World War II wrote in his memoir that this man was a great spirit of love. And the longtime chief rabbi of Rome after Zolli, Elio Tuaf, gave a lot of praise for the generosity of the pontiff during the World War atrocities. What changed so all of a sudden? It was the publication of a playwright called Der Stellvertreter. The English version is called The Deputy, in 1963. It was written by a German, Rolf Hochhuth, who portrayed him as a villain. Suddenly, the Pope came under fire. All of a sudden, the picture changed. But somehow, there was a wider plot. Just to notice that it was translated in more than 20 languages by translators who were Western communist or communist sympathizers. The Soviet newspaper Pravda had already started a campaign against the Pope and called him a fascist and an ally of Hitler. That was the new image of the Pope, thanks to the Moscow connection. And they continued to defame Pius XII. The first producer of The Deputy had joined the Communist Party already in 1919, and he worked for the Soviet intelligence during World War II. So the circle is closing. And more recently, General Ion Pacipa told us more details about this defamation plot in his book that I showed here. In KGB jargon, that's called framing. Radio Moscow had started that already by calling him the Hitler's Pope. But Pacipa could tell us much more what he did while he was in Romania under Ceausescu. They sent this Kais priest to the Vatican, who changed the archives, and that was used by Hooghoed in his research. So all of a sudden, the truth had been reversed. If you wonder who was behind all these atrocities, is that going to be Pius XII? Of course not. The real perpetrator is this man, and not Pius XII. So what was the relationship between the Nazis and the Church? Weren't many of them Catholics? True, Adolf Hitler was born a Catholic. They even called him the Catholic altar boy, but he had nothing to do with Catholic faith anymore since his childhood. Goebbels went to a Franciscan boarding school, Heydrich was Catholic, Müller was, and then there were a few who had a mixed background or had a Protestant background. But even if many were Catholics, all we can say is they were former Catholics and had converted to neo-paganism. It's clear that the real religion of the Nazis was not Catholicism. Goebbels said there is an insoluble opposition between Christian and heroic German worldviews. Bormann says Christianity and Nazism are incompatible. And Rosenberg said that the chief enemy of the Germans is Catholicism. So what was the position of the Church in Germany with the Nazis? These were three pillars, three cardinals that protested against the Nazis from the very beginning. Cardinal Vollhaber of Munich was a friend of Israel. He had the menorah in his coat of arms. Another cardinal from Münster, he denounced the Gestapo's lawlessness and the Nazi euthanasia program. And Cardinal Preising of Berlin was loathed by Hitler. They were all enemies of Hitler, and Hitler and the Nazis hated them. So they were involved with an encyclical that Pius XI, the predecessor of Pius XII, was going to be publishing. He had said already in 1938 that spiritually we are all Semites. Pacelli, who was his Secretary of State, took the lead in drafting that encyclical, which was called With Burning Anxiety. And the Nazis immediately responded by more suppression, more arrests of clergy, and Catholic presses were confiscated. The German title was Mit brennender Sorge, to make sure that Germans could read it and understand it very well and had no reason to say we did not know what was going on. And this is what this brief encyclical said. So did Pius XII cooperate with Hitler? It's hard to believe after all we have seen so far. Yet John Cornwell claims good propaganda, or Moscow propaganda. He even claimed that Pacelli had met Hitler. But the picture they put on the American version cannot be a proof for that. For the Pope left Germany in 1929. Pacelli, he was leaving a reception that was held by the then President Paul von Hindenburg. So we are changing history here. Still, we could ask, could he have done more? But that is not a good historical question. History does not tell us. Still, scholars of history go on and on by telling what had not happened in history. Besides, we have to realize there was a war going on, and that little Vatican City was surrounded by fascist regime in Italy. They were completely in control of all the physical supplies. And besides, in 1942, the Dutch bishops had declared them enemies of Nazism. By speaking out, many people lost their lives. So it was dangerous to do so. Here are some of those victims, the most well-known ones. But there were thousands of them. Edith Stein, who was a Jew and became a Carmelite nun. De Franciscan Father Maximilian Kolbe was in a concentration camp. Titus Brandsma was executed because he was the chaplain of the journalists in Holland and told them not to write favorably about Nazism. And these two priests were also, to just name a few. So the church was very careful, and yet there was a Vatican underground. The Scarlet in the Black is the movie that shows how Monsignor O'Flaherty did his underground work. And something similar can be said about the Assisi underground. But all these underground activities came from orders from the Vatican. Though many people told Pius XII to please flee, he remained solidly at his post. He was the hero to lead the church from there. But he did prepare a letter and says, "I will resignate if they capture me. I will no longer be the Pope. And if they ever assign a puppet Pope, like Napoleon had done before, be sure that that's not the Pope." Jewish testimonies tell us that in Rome, on Black Saturday in 1943, thousands of Jews survived and were protected in church-run institutions with the Pope's knowledge and support. He even opened his own summer residence at Castel Gandolfo. As the U.S. Holocaust Museum notes, for every Jew caught, at least 10 escaped and were hidden in the Vatican. The Israeli diplomat Pinchas Lapidus' book says that 700,000 to 800,000 Jews were saved from death by the church. These are Jewish testimonies, one by Gary Krupp, one by Gordon Thomas, and there are many, many more. The Jewish historian Anna Foer put it all clearly together in more general terms. The important impact of the Vatican and the Catholic Church to care of so many Jews. They were not indifferent to the fate of the Jews or even accomplices of the Nazis. Yet, Israel's World Holocaust Center in its museum section still promotes a distorted image of Pope Pius XII. In its original text in 2005, it still echoes the propaganda of Hochhut's play. In 2007, the text was revised and said that the Pope condemned racial mass murder. And in the 2012 version, it acknowledges the Vatican's role in the protection and rescue of Jews. So our conclusion is he is not Hitler's Pope. Rabbi David Dalin said it very clearly. It's a myth of Hitler's Pope. Cardinal Pacelli, when he was Secretary of State, he made some 55 protests against the ideology of race. In 1938, Pacelli publicly restated the words of Pope Pius XI. A Christian cannot take part in anti-Semitism. Spiritually, we are all Semites. I discussed many more details on the Holocaust in my book, Five Anti-Catholic Myths, Slavery, Crusades, Inquisition, Galileo, and the Holocaust. You can find it at angelicopress.com. It discusses also the myth of slavery, of the Crusades, of the Catholic Inquisition, of Galileo and the Inquisition, and about the Holocaust, but much more detailed than I could do in this short video.